Welcome back once again to Mary's Field. Bill Pfeiffer speaking. So good to be with you. It's Sunday. I saw over the weekend that Archbishop Salvatore Cordeleone, the Archbishop of San Francisco, told Nancy Pelosi that she no longer would be welcome at Holy Communion in his diocese, and that's a refreshing decision, actually, from the Archbishop. He said, after numerous attempts to speak with her to help her understand the grave evil she is perpetrating, she is perpetuating, the scandal she is causing, and the danger to her own soul she is risking, I have determined that the point has come in which I must make a public declaration that she is not to be admitted to Holy Communion unless and until she publicly repudiates her support for abortion rights. I think it's been a long time coming in a certain sense, but a welcome decision from the Bishop of San Francisco. When I was in college, I at one point had a course in philosophy and logic. And the first words out of the professor's mouth when we began the course were, I'm going to, if you stick with this course, I'm going to ruin you for the rest of your life. Well, I stuck with the course, and he indeed did ruin me for the rest of my life. We started out with a course in logic, and from that day on, after I had that full course in logic, everything I hear, everything I read, I always question the ultimate decision-making in that thing I am hearing or in the thing that I am reading. And I'm always looking, is that the truth? Is that the full truth? Is that full of integrity? Does that really have the character about it? And are there any false processes in the reasoning that lead people to believe this or that or the other thing? And one of the things that we did in that course was deal with a basic method of logic, which is called a syllogism. I taught this, in fact, to my students also in high school. A syllogism is a three-step process of logic. It consists of a major statement, usually a universal statement, beginning usually with all, a minor statement that's much more specific, and then a conclusion that hopefully expresses pure logic and good reason. For example, a universal statement might be all red buses go to Hartford. That's a universal statement, all universal. And then a minor premise, which would be this is a red bus. And then a conclusion, therefore, this bus goes to Hartford. Now, that's unassailable, perfect logic. You can't really argue with that. The problem is that the universal statement, the first statement, is not true. I also had a course in criteriology, which reflects on this kind of syllogism and asks, is it also true? Not only must things be logical, but they also should be true for us to be in right integrity, to have character, to be in a moral proper stance in our relationship with other people. So suppose the major statement is false, and really all red buses go to Hartford and to Bristol. Therefore, this is a red bus. Therefore, this bus goes to Hartford or to Bristol. The same thing is true when we get involved in things involving abortion. We can say all abortions are a matter of women's health and women's rights. That would be the universal major statement in a syllogism. This is an abortion. Therefore, this abortion is completely about women's rights and women's health. That would be a logical conclusion. You can't argue with that. That's unassailable. It's perfect logic. The problem is it's not true. You know, the major statement is all abortions are about women's rights and women's health. But the fact is, the major statement should be the universal. All abortions are about the killing of a baby. Therefore, the minor, this is an abortion. Therefore, the conclusion, this is about killing a baby. And so, You know, in one case, we're involved with pure logic, which is unassailable. But the important thing, because we're dealing with human life here, is that we also are dealing with truth. And that's really a critical thing. You know, I went to communion this morning, and I would not have been happy or comfortable if, either Nancy Pelosi or Joe Biden were either before me or behind me in line. The Eucharist is a sign and a cause of unity. It's the table of the Lord, and you know, forever and ever in the church's teaching, to approach that sacrament, one needs to be in some kind of a relationship with the Lord that is one of honesty and truth. And in this particular situation, particularly with someone who's in the public and says, I am a devout Catholic, and then pronounces herself to be completely in favor of abortion, it just doesn't follow. It just isn't right. Saint John Paul II declared, and I believe infallibly, and saying in his encyclical, The Gospel of Life, he says, I declare that direct abortion, that is, abortion willed as an end or as a means, always constitutes a grave moral disorder, since it is the deliberate killing of an innocent human being. This doctrine is based upon the natural law and upon the written word of God. It's transmitted by the church's tradition and taught by the ordinary and universal magisterium. No circumstance, no purpose, no law whatsoever can ever make it licit an act which is intrinsically illicit, since it is contrary to the law of God, which is written in every human heart, knowable by reason itself, and proclaimed by the church. The Pope is declaring here that this is a doctrine of faith. To be a Catholic, you need to believe this. You know, Mr. Biden and Mrs. Pelosi can still be Christians if they believe in Jesus and they're still Christians. It's just that they aren't any longer Catholic Christians, because a part of that unity that's essential is a belief that what is happening in abortion is really indeed the killing of a baby. So, you know, we really need to kind of be open to what is happening in this situation throughout the world. I know recently, I'm not sure if it was in connection with this or not, the Cardinal Archbishop of Washington was asked where he stands in all of this, and all he said was, I don't want to put a gun on the table. Well, that's chickening out. You know, if you don't want to answer the question, you know, you might want to say that, but you also have an obligation to all of the people in Washington and the rest of the world that are listening to speak the truth about this situation. To put a gun on the table, nobody puts a gun on the table. I say, take the gun off the table and really directly answer the question, where do you stand with regard to someone who's a political figure and pronounces something that is completely and absolutely contrary to everything that your church teaches. I think he has to really deal with that. Otherwise, we're ending up with all kinds of, confusion, confusing people, and so on. Abortion doesn't make you unpregnant. It makes you the parent of a dead child. That's just the news. That's just the truth, huh? Abortion does not end the life of a potential human person. It ends the life of a human person with great potential. Can it be that when we said we would no longer sit at the back of the bus, a place was being reserved for us at the abortion clinic? Alveda King, I believe the aunt of Martin Luther, Alveda King, you know, can it be that when we said we would no longer sit at the back of the bus, a place was being reserved for us at the abortion clinic? You know, if you read any of the words of Margaret Sanger, certainly the precursor of Planned Parenthood, her hatred, absolute hatred for African Americans, was unbelievable. She wanted to exterminate them, and you know, just a terrible, terrible thing. And so, you know, we really need to reflect on what is happening in this current situation and make sure that we're doing the proper thing. Americans are more frightened, really, of holiness, of truth, than we are of sinfulness in the current culture. You know, we're more frightened by what is right, by people of character, by people saying strong and clear and beautiful and truthful things than we are of people doing and saying and encouraging all kinds of sinful things. Early Christians spent time differentiating themselves from the culture in which they live. You know, American Christians spend all of their time trying to blend in. And as you blend in, you lose your integrity. You lose your faith. You become... you know, in the course of time, if you keep doing this, an apostate, you deny the things that you believe. Little by little, it just simply disappears. You know, and that's just not a right thing. So, you know, when you think back now, even just using pure logic, you know, the logic of a syllogism, you can't have it both ways. Something cannot be right and it cannot be wrong at the same time in the same way. That's totally illogical. And sometimes you can have logic, but you don't have truth. You know, remember, happiness tomorrow, what does it depend upon? It depends upon doing the truth today. And there's no excuse for not doing that truth and having that kind of integrity in our lives. So, there's a nice quote from Romans 12:2 that says, "Do not conform yourselves to this age, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that you may judge what is God's will, what is good, pleasing, and perfect." And that's the challenge that we have today. We need to be firm, to be clear, to be concise. You know, Pope Francis in his meeting with Mr. Biden and Ms. Pelosi, it was like a tea party, and I don't know how he had a serious obligation, I believe, to say something about the reason they came there. They came there for the reason of abortion, and all he talked about were immigrants and the poor and climate change. And that just was, when you're in that kind of a situation, you have a serious obligation to say something because everybody's expecting you to say something. So happiness tomorrow depends on doing the truth today. And I think that you know, each of us knows and recognizes the difference between logic and truth. Logic is one thing, criteriology, it deals with truth. And we are involved, certainly in Mary's field, and always talking about truth. Happiness tomorrow depends on the truth, not on the looking what looks like the truth or what appears to be the truth or seems to be the truth, but the objective truth. That is what frees. Nothing else does. Good to be with you. God bless. Looking forward to being with you again tomorrow.